All right, guys, I put it off as long as I can. Today is the day. We're going to take that MX-12 off there and go ahead and put on the AT-82. I believe that's it hanging on the wall. No, that's an 81. That must be the 82. Yeah, right down there is the 82. So we're going to be replacing that, putting it on here, getting ready to go. This weekend, we have a race at Brown's Camp. It's the Landfear GP, I believe. Did this one last year, and it was pretty good fun. They do a poker run on Saturday, and then the race on Sunday. It's more tight, single tracky than I really enjoy, but it's still fun. Get out and race with the boys. So, gonna get the bike all prepped up and ready, and go ahead and get that temporary number off of it. Get the tire switched out to the right one. Other than that, I think we're still good on air cleaner and oil change and everything. It's only had one race on it, hour and a half, so still good on all that stuff. Just do a quick look over on everything, make sure everything is good to go. But we need to get that tire switched. The MX-12 has really been really good. It's held up really great and everything, even with this patch in it that we blew out in Klein. But it's not going to be great for single track in the woods and the tight stuff. So gonna switch to the AT-82. Probably gonna run it scoop forward. That way we can get the best bite we can out of it. But gonna go ahead and get this all pulled off and we'll get started. Been a while since you guys watched shop work, so I guess we're back to that point. Go ahead and get some footage. And apparently the breaker bar was nuts. One size off is already out here. Oh, well, maybe two sizes off. Funny, so far going and riding and racing and all the races and stuff that I went to so far this year, I haven't taken the toolbox. I've tried to make sure that the bikes are prepped and done good enough that I'm not working on them while I'm at the track and stuff, which is probably, you know, dumb to not take the toolbox with me, but it is what it is. So far that's what I've been doing this year and haven't had an issue or a problem with it so far, but gonna have to get the toolbox back in the trailer one of these days so it can go with us. Dust caps always come off on me. Always. But that's okay. All right. Go ahead and get the tire changer pulled out from in the corner. Now that the winter's over, I can pretty much get rid of the heaters, get them stored up. We'll use them again in the fall. But we're not going to need them for the rest of the year, I can guarantee you that. And I've got to tighten the bottom of this. Where's my Allen wrench? There they are. Had it tight at one time, but must have come loose. As much reefing as I've done on this thing, it doesn't surprise me. As you guys probably know if you've watched the channel, changing tires is not my favorite thing at all. I wouldn't say I downright hate changing tires, but it's not very fun. Pull the valve stem out of the low pressure side first, and then we'll pull it out of the high pressure side. Trying to get the thing to kind of stand up a little bit. There we go. So like I thought, there was no pressure on the low pressure side at all. I didn't think there was. It's holding air good enough where if I kept pumping it up before each ride, it would hold. I never had it go down during a ride, but I knew it wasn't in very good shape. Now here's the test, and the real part that with tubeless that you want to see is that the high pressure side still got air. And it's got lots. It's actually hard to depress this one. To 120 psi, depending on how fast I could unhook the tire pump. And I'm really amazed looking at this tire. It is held up absolutely great. I would have to actually go back and look to see how many races and practice days I put on it. But I know for sure it's two or three. But they were all pretty much sand race. Well, not Eddyville's not sand. And I raced the bike on this at Eddyville. So Horn Rapids, Eddyville, and then I believe two different ones out at, no, it was only one race and one practice day out at High Desert MX. Because we raced the YZ for the other Sagebrush Classic. So it's got a couple races on it, a couple days riding on it, and it's still, you know, in really great shape. Get it right up here where you guys can see. Little tiny bit of rollover right on the big scoops, but all the side scoops and everything looking great. Nothing torn off. Pretty awesome. That's what we like to see a tire do. Last a long time and hold up to all the punishment. See where our bead lock is here. It's 14. And for some reason, my 14 is not there. There it is. Should go change my shirt or I'm gonna fuck up my Rachel Archer shirt. But oh well, it's not like it's a fancy shirt or anything. I'm sure she'd be fine with it getting all dirty. See if we can get the first scoop. For some reason, it's already pretty dry down in the bead. It's not even that hot out here. Man, I am sweating. Pretty much got one side off now. See if we can get it out of the bead lock. No problem. One side done. This is a tubeless tire, so it's a little different than putting than doing a tube tire. If you've done a tubeless before, you know. shove this down. We should be able to push it right off. Like that. So as you guys can see, this tubeless system is the oldest tubeless system that I have. This one has been on the bike. Well, the bike's got 100 hours on it now. So it's probably 95 hours. It's been ran through races with the tire completely flat multiple times at the end of the race. So some of this, whatever, rubber on top of the carbon fiber has worn down in some spots. Doesn't seem to bother it one bit so far. It doesn't leak air. The high pressure system maintains its pressure. So, yes, it's worn. Yes, it's seen better days. Nope, it's not a problem. Or at least hasn't been so far. Which has really impressed me and I'm really happy about, because I was wondering how tough the system would be. If it would be robust and last a long time. If it wouldn't, well, it's proven to be pretty tough. Pretty tough. Alright, went ahead and grabbed the brand new AT82 that we're going to be slapping on it. It's a 110 wide. The tire that we took off was a 110. This bike originally came with a 110 because it's a 250. I don't see any reason to change it from a 110. Especially with the low pressure system of the tubeless. If you need more traction, just let some more air out. And it will solve all your issues. I almost chose to go to Moose's this year, but being able to adjust the pressure is such a good thing that I just can't bring myself to go away from the tubeless system. That, and I really do feel like the tubeless system provides a better wheel lock. Like it's like having a complete bead lock. If you've ever been into four-wheel drive Jeeps and stuff, when they talk about bead locks on a, or rim lock on a Jeep, it's where all the way around your wheel it's locked to the rim. Well, with a bead lock, it only grabs one part of the tire and holds it. But with this piece here, it's pushing pressure all the way around. It makes it more like a traditional rim lock, like the four-wheel drive guys use on Jeeps and stuff. And I've never had a tire slip, even flat. So I can run these tires completely flat without air in them, if you have to. If the air leaks out or whatever, you can run them completely flat and the tire will not spin on the rim. But people who just run one bead or rim lock, I've heard them talk about spinning the rim. Well, I've never had that happen. Not with the tubeless system, so. Let's see if we can get her going in here. Down inside the tube, that would suck. We'd be looking for that in a little bit. Bingo! So now our wheel is inside the tire on both sides. Pop it over here a little bit. Take the metal piece out. Man, everything wants to fall inside the tire today.
Come on now. There we go. Now this is the part that I always struggle with, trying to get the first chunk of the rim under the beadlock. Grab my bead, buddy. Oh, it fell down inside the... never thought about that before. So better not put that down in there no more. And then we'll just start trying to work it around. Hopefully it'll suck itself under the beadlock with my help. Oh, that looked like it sucked in there good. I didn't even check to see which way we were putting it on. So this is the brake, this is on this side. Damn it, we put it on backwards. Oh well. We're committed now. So we'll have really good braking. I don't think it's going to make that big a difference to run it one way versus the other. All right, one side on. I'm sweating like crazy. Are you guys focusing on the right area? Pretty much. Probably boring as shit to watch me do this again, especially since I'm not good at it. Take this whole thing down to Jay Clark down there in California. He's done so many tires, he could do this in like 2 seconds flat. Alright, I think it might go right in that rim lock and be good to go. That's what I like to see. This tire is actually very soft. I don't know if it's the temperatures because it's very warm today, so it's nice and flexible, or if this tire is just a soft enough tire that it's very easy to put on. Of course, now that I say that, the last couple bites are going to be nice and tough. Beautiful. And there we go. Tire done and on. I always take it off and bounce it a little bit just to make sure that everything is kind of set where it wants to sit. And then we'll come over to our rim lock and tighten it up. There we go. So as you guys can see, after you get used to doing the tubeless tire changes, you can do them fairly quickly, especially if the tire is like this one is a softish tire, it's feeling pretty good, or if you have all the whatever actual soaps and stuff to put around the rims. I always just use soap and water. Dawn dish soap and water. It works fine to me. I'm sure there's tons of better stuff to use, but none of it's as cheap as Dawn dish soap. Throw the valve stem back in it, and then I'm going to put some air in it before I tighten up the bead lock all the way. Make sure that everything's setting on the bead. Make sure everything pops out and puffs up nicely. And then we will be set. Throw it back in the bike, make sure everything's tightened up. Give the bike a once over and everything. Get that other number off the front of it. My electrician's tape F is still holding up. So we can run the numbers, which I'm pretty sure we're gonna have temporary numbers. We always end up having temporary numbers, but we'll see. Both valve stems back in. I'm gonna go grab the air pump real quick. Be back. All right, so I grabbed our pump real quick. And if I remember right, what I wanna do first on this thing is I wanna air up the low a little bit. So the low pressure side, and see if it will hold air. A lot of times it won't because it's not beaded like that. double check my hose is on right. Yeah, I just don't think it will. So what we're going to do is we're going to air up the high pressure side. And what this should do is it should push the rim out to the bead. Maybe it is just the hose. I've had problems with this thing lately. Come on now. There we go. So now as we start to put pressure into the inside, this is that inside of the red piece. There's a tube inside there. And as that red tube slowly pushes out to the rim, it'll push the beads right out to the rim of the tire. Got a little chunk over here that's being sticky. We're only at like 40 PSI right now. All right, so I'm gonna stop right there for a minute. 40 PSI. And go ahead and take it off both sides and bounce it. So this side's pretty much all on the rim. The other side too. All right, and then with it down here on the ground, which makes it easier to pump, I'll go ahead and take that high pressure to 100 to 120, whatever I can get it to. And that's what I mean by only ever being able to get it to 100 PSI. So you might be able to get it to 120, but maybe your pump is better than mine. But just in that disconnecting of it, if I hook this right back up, it would probably be down at 90 PSI. Even if I went to 120, because that is just enough. And that tube inside is just a little tiny tube. So it lets that pressure out really quick. So now that I have that inner one all the way tight, I'm going to go ahead and tighten the bead lock. The rim should be fully beaded up now, and the rim lock is just kind of locking it in place. And you don't have to worry about doing the bead lock or the rim lock super tight, because like I said, the whole thing becomes a rim lock. So that right there, I'm just gonna call that good. Fairly tight. And then we'll go ahead and air up the low pressure side to probably just 20 for now. Let it set at 20 PSI. Alright, there we go. So now our tire and rim should be good to go. Feels super tight. Balance is good. At 20 PSI, it's pretty tight. But that's what I want it to be right off the bat. Easy to tell when you're leaking at 20 PSI. Don't have to try hard to notice that. And I think that's all we need to do. The bearings were all replaced not too long ago, all good. Get the spacer back in here. Once I get that set up in there, I'm gonna go ahead and take just a little extra grease and just slap a little grease on this. I'm gonna spray it with soap and water first and kind of wipe it off. Kind of clean it first. Even though nothing actually rotates on this, it all rotates on the bearings. I don't want this to get seized in place or get galled up and stuck on a bearing or anything. I want it to be able to slide in and out super easy. That's what the grease is for too, is so that it doesn't actually get any rust or corrosion on it. There we go. Just a super fine coating of some Maxima grease. And it will be ready to go. Grab me out a screwdriver real quick so I can spread my brake pads. Oh, come on now. The back bike. You piss me off. Stay on your stand while you put on a fucking tire. Bam! Well, hold on before I put that spacer on. get it to back out enough. I can get the spacer to come out a little bit. There we go. Now that the spacer's past the nut, it should be able to walk right on. Why wouldn't it walk on the other way? That's stupid. Anyhow, now we got. And there we go. Tire is done and re-back home. Good to go. So the second part of getting everything ready is we need to go refill our quick fill can with some race gas. Probably not going to fill the actual bike up. It's still like half a tank. But I want to go get my can out on the trailer filled up with the race gas. Get it ready to go. So that'll be the second part. And then we're pretty much done. I want to go ahead and take the YZ out for one more trip this week. Today's only Tuesday. This will be our midweek maintenance video. I'm going to take the YZ out and go for another trip around in the woods on Wednesday. And then probably won't ride again until Saturday. Give my arms and everything some rest. But this should finish up the rest of the getting everything prepared and ready. And everything should be good to go. Whoop whoop. Hope you guys enjoyed.